you for Michael Simmons-Robert for the privilege of reading. My first time at the Whitworth Gallery. Don't know Manchester very well, I've come up from Leicester. So thank you very much. I enjoy working in lots of different forms, some more experimental than others. And this is one of those poems. Also imagining to be other than I am. My life as a bat. A wish to be a bat, ricocheting in a cave, all caricature, daring. Some might say devil, whose echolocation leads me to my prey. Fierce, fiercer in flight, ghost of an old world gorging on twilight. Haunting houses, yours. Infiltrating your study to spawn jelly-eyed babies on your laptop. My kind laugh, cry, and scream. Listen. You pad to the window, may even open it. There's a new smell in the bedroom, not unfamiliar. Ouch. We go for veins plumped by sleep. I have very small teeth, remember? A wish some might think strange, but it's not so silly. Truth is, it would be fun to flit under your half-open blinds on a hot night, land victorious in bed between the two of you, like a weird forgotten child with waxen wings. X-ray vision I won't have as a bat, but I can smell your fear. See how guilty you look when, without zoppy clothes, she wakes to a bizarre petting zoo. Thank you very much. I'm going to read two more poems. They're both from a pamphlet, quite an old one now, called Show, Date and Time. And the first one, it's about a job application, and it's for the kind of job I don't think I'd get. Application for the post of Mother Nature. Late May, the gorgeous coppery wild cherry is shadowing the lawn. I'm typing this by desk light, remembering last month's hail, the lawn's crisp glaze, and how this morning I jiggled the lock on the patio door to look for my son's trainer. Finding it in the lilac bush, I snatched here and there, deadheading, sampling scents. The net was off the pond, I draped it back, and imagined the fiefdom of the ghost koi, his orange underlings, a heron swaying in an elm two roads away. Oh, and yesterday, a fox, all housebreaker's swagger, eyeballed me, then slotted himself through a neighbour's fence. My past and present experience. Maybe I lack desirable requirements. I'm neither bosomy, nor with tactile hands, a stay-at-home, nor a wildly roaming seeker of skies and herbal lore. Not rhetorical, empyrean, unable, like Titania, to describe this mazed world with its complicated seasons. But I'm typing this by desk light. The cherry steps back in twilight, her big hair still. And those are my referees, city kids, wired from PlayStation, TV. And those are their mates, tall, white-faced 15, round the pond, trainers never far from the ball, staying near. They keep it near, sticks like a terrier. Then one voice cracking, wider than the gaps in crazy paving, yelps, look, a frog. Okay, you can see that's quite dated, PlayStations. I'm not sure the status of those these days, to be honest. The final poem I'll read is in two parts. It derives from a walk along a canal bank just outside Leicester some years ago when there was a fishing competition going on. Lots of anglers, lots of rods, lots of seriousness looking at the water, and my husband and myself had to tread over each rod to the rather angry expressions of the anglers. So it's in two parts. The first part's from the point of view of somebody on a boat, and the second part is one of the fishermen. The point of view. The fishing competition. I want to sit on a canal bank, but nowhere near those fishermen and their triumphal arch of rods, their stinking jars of maggots, their cans of long life. Before a fish is dangled like a dark, dripping slipper, I want to be away at the next lock, helping a pleasant elderly couple prise the gates apart. Then with them pass, oh so slowly, through the tidy, lovely water, upping the engine's disruptive growl, so that the winning bite sashays downstream, and the maggot on each line's untasted. Though the poor we leave behind will be stared at, sifted, long after the women at home have packed up and moved on. It's entirely Zen, this waiting. It's the quality of waiting that counts in the end. To tame the monkey mind, the human tendency to shake, to twitch. The synaptic response to a flicker of wind on a line, the mock bite of weed, tease of a current. Let your mind flow and flower like the hawthorn blossom on the bank. He who waits will be rewarded. People on narrow boats call, "Caught any yet?" or "What's the point?" You'll explain yet again that the point isn't in what's pulled out, but in what's thrown back. You're reassured when your neighbour, a few feet away, does exactly the same as you. And the light fades, and the midges dance stir-crazy over the skin of things. You want to feel it one more time. You can't even see to the end of your line. You suspect this is the nearest you'll ever get to love.
But the first of our readers tonight, and the winner of the third prize, is Pam Thompson for her poem, My Life as a Bat. This was a smart, witty poem with a real edge and a sting in the tail. It's formally ambitious and adept, built around an abecedarian structure, i.e. it's got the alphabet thread through it, but it manages to maintain, despite these formal elements in place, a real fluency and energy throughout. So, Pam Thompson.